There is no way and no mechanism to stop that narrative of different human evolutionary groups at different evolutionary levels, with some groups being superior to others, from being a potential conclusion of Darwinian thought. And of course, we have numerous quotations by Darwin himself to prove this point, along with his two companions, Huxley and Haeckel. Second, even if the same primate ancestors were assumed and the previous concept of different human evolutionary paths scrapped, then the Darwinian paradigm would still spawn in the same problem regardless. They believe evolution happens, is happening, and continues. Therefore, the different human racial groups, in response to different environmental stimuli from different places on Earth, would be evolving in different ways. And it would be concluded as a matter of logical default, with no other alternative, that if it were so, one group of humans would indeed be genetically superior over another through the course of time. In a worldview where the a priori belief is that the purpose of life, all life, including human life, is for different and competing bioforms going through the process of evolution to fight for dominance and exterminate weakness from the Earth, you could only expect, at the best, the same results that it yielded in the past, when applied on a social level, which was well visible in the quotations of General Lothar von Trotha saying, quote, Darwin's law, survival of the fittest, end quote, which he uttered as the Darwinian Germans slaughtered the Herero and Nama people in South Africa. Likewise, the same sentiment of the Nazi propaganda film, Victims of the Past, saying, quote, in nature, all weak things are destined to die out, end quote, with reference to the Jewish people. The same psychopathic ideology, the same psychopathic actions. That is all you can expect from Darwinism. That is logical to assume. It only becomes a matter of waiting for the sufficient passage of time and sufficient educational manipulation in the public school system to blot out the memory of those quotations and the role they played in the terrible massacres of recent history. In fact, as a consequence of the philosophical presets of the obsessive idea of survival of the fittest, it would be predicted as an inevitable logical consequence that the radically committed Darwinist, firm in their belief, will take it a step further, seeing technological advancement as another form of human evolution in a world of struggle for dominance and progression. That idea will occur as a sort of secondary or tertiary mental illness brought on by the natural logical paths of presuming Darwinian explanations to be truth, without examination, scrutiny, or thinking it through. That will bring about a catastrophic set of moral problems once again, as it always did in the past. And considering that it was less than 50 years from the publishing of Darwin's book to them being quoted as a justification for violence while the decapitated heads of the Herero people were scraped clean as an evolutionary paraphernalia and proof text of Aryan superiority to be placed in museums, considering it changed the world in such a way so quickly, then you must be forced to say the clock is truly ticking. What stops Darwinists from experimenting on the human body, their own, or those of others in the name of a practice of the exploration of so-called evolutionary potential? For example, the mingling of man and machine together, implants into the body in an attempt to make what they see as weak and insufficient mankind into a more improved and evolved form, which they would call a biomechanical synthesis, a mixture of the original biological creation with man-made technological pieces. And since it so happens that a lack of believing in an observing, fiery, punishing God ready to destroy people would be foolish enough to attempt to modify, tamper with the human code, arrogant enough to think that they could improve the human genetic code, there ceases to be any auxiliary inhibitor or force of cessation to stop so-called Darwinian scientists from producing this kind of abominable human experimentation. In fact, human experimentation was always part and parcel with the worldview. We would remember well Mengele injecting strange substances into the eyeballs of the poor Jewish children in the concentration camps. And since they probably value their own life and understand that there is risk involved in human experimentation, the risk of debauching and annihilating their own genetic codes and making it worse, what happens when one group of humans and the so-called Darwinian scientists want to experiment on humans in an attempt to drive their mythological evolutionary pursuit further, but are afraid of harming themselves directly, wanting to learn the dangers first from the observations of another? Well, it's simple. Seeing that their worldview is anti-theistic in nature and assumes that there is no punishing God to fear punishing humans with hellfire for such experimentation, odds are they take liberty and will perform the human experimentation on other human groups outside their own families and preferred people groups, as much as possible and for as long as possible. They would probably be willing to experiment on these other human beings without them even knowing it, without informing them in advance. They probably feel no motivation to ask for permission from what they see as a less evolved failure in human evolution, waiting to be exterminated from the gene pool, a dead-end human evolutionary path. In their perspective, the most noble thing the so-called less evolved humans can do is to sacrifice their bodies and minds and existences and families for the sake of psychopathic, more evolved intellectuals in the name of science, or else die out through massacre or warfare, and thus leaving behind what they assume are precious and limited physical resources, for example, land, water, and food, stone, metal, etc. And that belief, limited and finite resources, is again itself another working of the anti-theistic and atheistic worldviews, not informed by a belief in an all-powerful creator God who is able to provide the needs for every human being ever birthed. But in the eyes of the Darwinian view, there probably is not enough to go around, seeing that they do not have a capable and loving Heavenly Father whom they can trust to provide beyond what their eyes see. Ideologies have consequences. Now ask yourself, what happens when the psychopathic Darwinist scientist type of thinker steps into places of political power in our modern world? Ask yourself this while you are at it. What if the Darwinist scientist adopts secondary and tertiary belief systems, such as a dedication to the communist vision of social utopia according to Marx's methods? Well, you will not have to go far to find these people. As I pointed out in my first four books, Darwinism and Marxism are two forms of social atheism and anti-theism that are basically two symbiotic systems, deeply interlinked and connected, which were intentionally organized to enable the overthrowing of Judeo-Christian concepts of moral law. The very laws that allowed us to enjoy mutual existence and the creating of families with a measure of peace. The two systems are equally dependent on support from one another. In the Marxist-controlled public schools, Darwin's evolution is always taught, and the propaganda of Jurassic Park and Land Before Time is never far off. The relationship of the ideologies of Darwinism and Marxism to Holocausts and the kind of world leaders that put them into effect. What is the relationship? Well, it should be very clear at this point. Darwinian thought is a great avenue for manufacturing the very type of controlling human massacre and unlawful, unwelcome experiment justifying psychopaths we tend to hate the most. The very ones who engineer the disgusting massacres and the racism that we despise. It is the natural outshoot of the Darwinian worldview. Marx's system is similar enough in many ways. Instead of biological evolution, he promotes a concept of evolution of social systems and structures of governance in the way he portrays his narrative in the manifesto, all things growing, evolving, and changing towards a final social utopia, the culmination of communism, which they see as the ultimate and inevitable governmental system of human social development. By making the outrageous and foolish statement that communism abolishes eternal truth, religion, and morality in Chapter 2 of the Communist Manifesto, they open the gates to every idiotic and insane idea imaginable to man, seeing that the basis of all human intellectual pursuits and educational development presumes the existence of absolute truth or eternal truth, and their discoverability in the presence of a system of differentiation for true from false. But Marxists abolish that fundamental concept upon which all real education is formulated, which is to say they engineer social madness and insanity artificially. These are the same ones trying to legislate and threaten us, to force us to call a woman walking around with a plastic imitation male genital strapped on Mr. or Sir. But that is false. Why should we proclaim something to be true if it is false? Well, to them it is not necessarily false if you abolish eternal truth. For if you do so, all the false things and the true things have become the same and interchangeable, absolutely abstract and meaningless. A huge component of our modern mental illnesses is certainly spawning readily enough through the constant regurgitating of this manifesto of nonsense in our public schools and universities here in the West. If you ask me my private opinion, those Darwino-Marxist books and ideologies should be banned and persecuted and discriminated against, and I will probably recommend something to the effect later in the book. Note I said ideologies and books, not people per se, though some punishments might help guide the deluded people out of their illusion of mythology of biological and social evolution, the false religion with which they keep presenting human beings other than themselves as unwilling human sacrifices to build up their temple made of human skulls. These are the exact same ones trying to lock us into our homes and divide us against one another on a fictional and artificial basis in the current season between 2019 to 2021. It is the classical method of the communists to manufacture a victim-oppressor narrative. Bourgeoisie versus proletariat. Bourgeoisie evolves into kulak when implemented in Soviet Russia, evolves into white man when implemented in the current Western world. Simultaneously, the use of libel and all fiction to turn an entire human group against another human group by causing them to see the other group of humans as the enemy, as parasites. Or in general, the more recent version is to view them as the threat to our public health and safety, and to label them in such a way. And I find myself more and more hating the word public for that reason. All these narratives we do see in our current season. If I look at the Charter of Rights and Freedoms in my own country, I can clearly see that numerous elements have been thrown down in favor of legislation that directly reflects the list of 10 items in Chapter 2 of the Communist Manifesto. If you cross-reference the manifesto's list of 10 and the moves by so-called public health presently occurring, you see the exact same pattern. It could not be more painfully obvious from the fact that the first Director General of the World Health Organization, Dr. Brakje Kisom, was known for paraphrasing Communist Manifesto terminology as his personal worldview that the organization he once ran is now forefront in causing problems for our various national charters and constitutions in the name of what is questionably called science, but seems to be a work of utter fiction. How can I be so bold to declare that another Holocaust is probably going to happen soon in our modern time? Simple enough. Take a look around you. The ideology of psychopaths and control freaks and people with a sickly obsession of the idea of playing God with other people's lives. That ideology of Darwino-Marxism has not gone anywhere. It is still in our midst, plaguing us. It is still ruling our public school systems. I personally find it laughable that the opening statement of the Communist Manifesto says that there is a spirit haunting Europe, the spirit of communism. Seeing that Jesus Christ said, quote, I am the way, the truth, and the life, end quote, which is for him to call himself eternal truth, and seeing that he also introduced a very potent system of morality and religion to us, which played a massive part in bringing our modern luxuries to us, if you study the history of the development of the scientific method, for example, it also became the basis for most of the fundamental and functional elements of our constitutions in Western society. And yet they say in the Communist Manifesto, we abolish eternal truth, which is to say we abolish Jesus Christ. Then this makes a lot more sense. Naturally, they abolish our constitutions, our charters, our rights and freedoms haphazardly as well. And they also abolish our families, they abolish our humanity, and they abolish our lives as they please. Whoever controls the Darwino-Marxist parties is apt to do that, abolishing anything and everything that offends them, which seems to be the most principal and basic elements of human existence. They abolish that. And as for science, Darwinian evolution and all evolutionary theory is extremely flimsy. The creation scientists have pointed this out increasingly, but few get to hear their arguments, which are actually scientifically sound, in most cases, seeing that the Darwino-Marxists are heavily involved in censoring competing views in the scientific community, and refuse to allow them any representation in the public schools, which they do, contrary to law, illegally, not surprisingly, since they keep, quote, abolishing, end quote, law according to their communist agenda anyways. The attempt to exterminate the story of carbon-dated dinosaur bones was a great example, seeing that it was a direct threat to the flimsy 65 million years narrative. In the same way, they have been censoring matters of the current trouble of 2019 to 2021 so heavily that I have to be careful not to use certain words in my ebook lest I trigger blocking mechanisms from a censorship algorithm in the name of, quote, public health interests, end quote. Indeed, they are apt to cancel the truth that they cannot handle. With all that said, as the title indicated, these two ideologies are a chief factor in the enabling of slaughter. The Communist Manifesto declares openly in its fourth chapter, they have a world to win. The Manifesto is one of the few worldview documents or books that expressly mentions that its agenda includes taking over the world, and it also mentions expressly that they are willing to use force to do it in numerous places. In fact, this is where Karl Marx differed the most from other socialists and preachers of utopia. Karl Marx was more realistic in his idea of establishing utopia not through an evangelistic oral crusade, but by inspiring physical revolutions with guns and bloodshed. He himself mentioned this in Chapter 3 of the Communist Manifesto in his commentary on Critical Utopian Communism, another sect of the same belief system most known by the methods of men and women such as George Bernard Shaw and Sidney Beatrice. All the ideological enabler statements and the modus operandi is there for incurring a holocaust and a massacre in the prevalence of the narrations of Darwin and Marx. They corrupt everything they touch, even the medical field and the medical sciences. Now let us flesh out the details of what that inevitably spells out for us. A revival of Nazi Germany's final solution is surely inevitable with these types of ideological systems mentioned previously running rampant in chairs of political and economic power.